I think the human being is very inconsistent, because when a vow seems to suit their self-interest, they're very much, you know, but you said, and you know, you must keep your word. But if we look through each person's life, we're not keeping our word, and you cannot keep it. It's best not to get into too much situations where, you know, you must keep your word, meaning that you're making a lot of promises, you're saying a lot of things, as though you are the one who determine the flow or the stream of existence. We cannot do this. Having said that, then does it mean then a person's word should mean nothing at all? Not at all like that. As much as possible, if something feels true in your heart, you can say, this I feel. I feel strongly about this at the moment, but I realize that nothing I say can be fixed forever. I think it's a fantasy, a spiritual fantasy of human beings to think that they can make a vow or a promise that they will keep forever. There are some beings who their mentality, their mind, their consciousness is so stable that they can say a thing and somehow it seems that it gets fulfilled like that. But for the regular person whose mind is immersed in the ego, they have no such power. They have no such power. Because if we really did have that type of power, then we could also determine exactly the existence we want and live it. You don't have this power. We can say that, and there's a beautiful way in which I've heard it expressed, that a certain thing is like this for now. Because you cannot guarantee. It sounds wonderful to some part of us that likes to feel that we can live in someone else's promise, or you can live with someone else's guarantee. At most, it can be a declaration of the love that you feel now. Not that love needs to be fickle and always changing, you know, I love you, then I don't love you, I love you, I don't love you. It's not like that, because I don't think that this is the way true love really is. But when we say, I promise to love you forever, and I promise that I'll always be with you, it's a beautiful sort of sentiment in a way. But who can keep it, actually? Because I've seen that sometimes in life, there comes a time when, you know, two people are just not, they're not flowing, energy is not flowing. And it's not that, oh, you know, one person just decides. It's like something is not flowing. And maybe both people feel a very strong sense of commitment that, you know, we want to honor our commitment. But quite often, when you get to a certain point, if you're not in affinity with each other, if you're not resonating with each other, you don't feel that, you know, you should use your vow as a way of staying together. It more feels like it's a pressure, that something has changed, the orientation of the heart has changed or something. And especially there are times when you do know these things deeply, that the feeling of love or commitment to this person, something has changed. And you're going to say, but I promise to be like this with you forever. Then it feels very different. Then why are you doing that then? It's like your word is more important than your heart. And we say many things, and it's not like that. I think the people who get married and they make a kind of vow, sometimes it's very moving to feel that we reach a certain place in our life where at a point you feel to dedicate your existence to being with someone else. It's a beautiful sentiment, it's a beautiful feeling. And many people have successful marriages. But there are many people who they don't have the spiritual maturity to be in a relationship forever. Either they don't have the spiritual maturity, or that your partner and yourself not that compatible, whichever way it is, and you're not able to sustain a promise of that magnitude. I mean, if someone says, you know, if I give my word, I keep it, I would like to see such a person. As much as possible, we do keep our word. It must mean something. If I say, as we become more spiritually secure inside the heart, your words do have a stronger import. They have a stronger power. For myself also, I feel I have a love for you that doesn't change. It doesn't diminish. It's not dependent on whether you're nice or not nice. Sometimes I have to keep away from you, but my love is never separated. But I know that people I've been in relationship with me in the terms of like their spiritual connection, it seems, and whose love has turned to acid hate for things that is just all the workings of their mind. What can they promise me? I don't take a promise from another human being. But I know that the love that arises from the state that I am is true. And it doesn't fluctuate because it's not a contract. It's not a kind of an exchange even. It is just there. It's unavoidable. So I don't fall out of love with people in the spiritual sense. I don't do it. And yet at the same time, I feel that the love of most human beings is very fickle. Now I love you and I'll be with you. And next minute, now they're kind of stabbing you in your back, you know. It can be like this. So how can such a person make a vow that has any such a depth of credibility? If your mind is not stable, if your sense of who you are is founded upon the wrong notions, how can what you say be so stable? And such ideas like, you know, yeah, you do it in the presence of God. Like, you know, like God is going to say, ha-ha, you gave your word, why didn't you keep it? That's a joke. He knows you can't keep it. Nothing you say is that strong. He's glad you cannot keep your word, so that you may come to see that the words that come from the mouth of a man who is not immersed in the heart, they have no validity. There's nothing ultimate about it. How can God be disappointed? This is a complete joke. It's a very childish idea about God. He's going to hold you, you know, you said it in front of God. God is the first one to say, listen, relax. Don't take yourself so seriously. When have you ever said anything that is true? You see? So we mustn't be afraid of these things. Because you at the time said what you say in good faith. Whether you have the capacity, and certainly you cannot determine for someone else, I'm going to love you, we're going to be compatible for the rest of our lives. Some people, the destiny of their relationship is meant to be for a short time. Whatever you're meant to learn or to experience through that encounter, maybe it's for a certain duration and you go. There are some beings who are going to be with you for the rest of your earthly life. You walk together shoulder to shoulder. There are some people with whom you're going to have a deep connection in the heart for all your lives, as far as the energy portrays a life is concerned. And sometimes you cannot tell why. You push each other away, you push each other off a bridge, but you can't separate. Something is just there all the time. It just has this beautiful love, this consistency. And another one, you know, they have a 5-star wedding, 100,000 people, 15,000 pound cake, and they can't stay. In 1 month they're separating. So who can say these things? So my feeling is as well, some of you, maybe your destiny is to be in my physical company for the rest of whatever. And others, maybe not in a physical, maybe more your connection in the heart is stay strong and distance makes no, physical distance has no real meaning for you. And others will move on and go a different path, travel a different road, do different things. I don't know about these things. It's not my business. But if the people are going to be with me, I can see you every day for the rest of my life. But you have to be fresh. Just don't be stale. Don't live just like you cannot eat yesterday's. Well, yeah, we've been eating yesterday's dinner.
I shouldn't.
You cannot live on last week's food. For sure, even people who have no declared spiritual posture have relationships that go on for all their lives and can be happy. So there's no guarantee. But certainly, there is not a set standard for relationships. Some are fleeting and have very deep potency, depth of experience, deep connection, but are short in their duration in terms of the physical nearness or something. There are so many different ways. But I really feel that we need to relax a little bit. A human being who has not, whose mind has not yet merged inside the heart, such a human being cannot be, relied upon in every case. And anyway, you should not rely upon anyone, because usually you're relying on them based upon your projection or what you want from them. We should not make commitment, unless you really feel it in your heart, and you may say, I love you and I promise love you for the rest of my life. And it feels so beautiful in that moment, and then things change, and if you're both intelligent, you can both understand and say, you know what, we love each other, but somehow our lives are not flowing together so well, and let's be good friends, and people have these type of relationships also. They move on, they keep touch with their ex-partners, and it's clean, it's beautiful, because you say, we walked shoulder to shoulder for so much time. You've been my teacher, you've been my friend, you've been so many things. How can I, be walking in another direction and cut you from my heart? It's not possible if your love is true. It cannot be like that. But there are some relationships which seem to flourish and do really beautifully, really, really well. Usually people who are very comfortable, rested in their own heart, have good ways of communicating. And I would say, above all, someone who has a good sense of self, who is not easily destabilized, who doesn't suffer from insecurity. Because that's the worst, that's the cancer of relationships. To always be insecure, always require someone to tell you, I love you and you're the most important. This is very poor. You should be strong enough to stand on your own. But we don't have to make so many promises, that's the point. We don't have to make so many promises. Sometimes they sound great. Some people, their weakness is making promises to other people. I promise you I'll do this. Oh, I'm going to do this. And then they haven't got the stamina. It's like you're running a marathon, but you're running like a sprinter. And you get off to a fine start, and then 50 meters up, you're leaning up against a tree or something, and everybody's passing you. Because you get a thrill out of demonstrating affection for a few minutes, but there isn't a backup to sustain it or something. All these things. But I really want to, if I can, just to say that nobody can disappoint God. Or make God angry. These type of things, they are very, very, show the human fallibility to say such things, and such a limited and narrow view of the Supreme Being. We are, in each of our expression, one of the stage names of God. Each one is a mask of God. While we are in the notion that we are just people, there's an narrowness in that. But when we come to real understanding, your life becomes so much lighter, so much brighter when you find the truth. That nobody puts you here to beat you. We beat ourselves, actually, by expecting the impossible. In a silly way. But as far as relationships are concerned, I think when someone tries to hold you, but you said you would, it's the most horrible thing to do. Because we are saying many things that we can't fulfill. And as you come more to find your own strength, you're not inclined to make promises. Because you see the futility of them and the unfairness. They're very unreasonable. So I feel that when we do that with each other, it shows a real lack of understanding of life, of consciousness, of just of existence. It's very narrow. And out of that type of, holding you to your word, it never comes anything beautiful. Just pain and pressure. It doesn't end up with a smile at all. So just let each other be free. And trust. If there's something there, you don't have to be going around you know, peeping only on each other. You know, if something trust is there, then something relaxes more. But it takes time to trust, and I believe that people should slow down, take time to trust. Don't have the arrogance of thinking, well, because you're going out with me, you should trust me. Most human beings are so untrustworthy. So trust has to be developed and matured or something. But I think we can relax a lot more about these things. Don't think that another human being is here to make you happy. The purpose of their existence is to make you happy. It's a real arrogance. But you can be happy with many people. You can be happy with one person in a certain kind of relationship. It can be very beautiful, very sweet. Or peeping means, you know, like snooping and looking and checking in to see if they're up to some mischief. It's all to do with insecurities and a lack of trust. And if these are the signs that are happening with us, don't hold the other person responsible. You have to really go inside yourself and say, why should I, you know, the once upon a time you didn't know each other. How did you come to be so, to trespass into the being of someone so deeply? And before another time you didn't know them, you know. So we bring these propensities with us, these tendencies, and then we point them towards other beings, make them almost responsible for the way we feel, and this is not the truth. Because love cannot be expressed at the point of a gun, you know. You said you love me. Yeah, I did say that, but I couldn't manage it. I just couldn't keep it up. You scared the hell out of me.
What about adultery? One of the things we promise ourselves is to be faithful. What do you think about that?
To be faithful, first of all, means to be faithful to your own heart. This is what faithfulness is. Be faithful to your own self, to be truthful. Not in a selfish, not in an ego-centered way. But to honor your own self. This is the capacity we have. As I said before, I'm not totally comfortable about promises. Sometimes we may make promises to each other, but there must be a lightness, an air of some playfulness in it. It cannot be taken, you know, like a kind of contract. You cannot say, okay, tomorrow at 22 minutes to 2 o'clock, you're going to have a certain feeling. Can you say this? You cannot say that. You can say it, but it won't have any meaning. You cannot say how you're going to feel tomorrow. You cannot say this thing. You can say it like jokingly, you know, okay, in the next half an hour, do you know precisely what feelings you're going to be feeling, what thoughts you're going to be having? You have no control over it. You can say, okay, in half an hour we're going to talk about, you know, John the Baptist or something. And, you know, please get prepared, and people read about it and so on. And I say, okay, fine, what do you think of John the Baptist? And you're talking, but that's not really being in touch with the moment. We can live like that, but I don't feel that we need to. Fresh is the moment, which is unplanned. It just arises, and it's like, this is fine. There is a place and a time for planning things, but you'll come to know when those moments are. You will not do them out of habit, out of weakness. There are some people, they have this tendency to continuously put entries into their diaries. Even for the next 2 years, if there's a diary, they'll fill it up with intention. Can you fulfill them? No, it's just a habit. Or to make promise, or to make big promises to people you cannot keep. And this is why quite often I feel we're not in the moment, we don't really know ourselves in the moment. We know ourselves in the past, we know ourselves into the future projections. But about the present, very people give anything. Because the present is not an interpretation of itself, it's just there. But the mind finds it's not enough. We have to spice it up with some projections or some expectations or something like this. And then we suffer from the very projections that we encourage. I don't find these things are really nurturing to love. I think they are misguided and misunderstood, ill-conceived. They're not the fragrances of real love. That love is to be discovered, not created. There is something in relationships that's part of the way in which consciousness enjoys its existence, its play. We see also in the scriptures, even in India, you have, you know, these models, Krishna, Radha, Shiva, Parvati, and these, they point to something which is very pure. But some people can't manage it.